Okay, I would like to start with a personal narrative which will give you some sense about my project. On 14 December 1984, I was sitting at the news department, the Voice of Israel, South Israel, the Lugat al-Arabiya, and our correspondent had just informed us that the poet Anwar Shaul, Iraqi Jewish poet, had passed away in Kiryat Ono, a small town near Tel Aviv. We broadcast the news with a detailed biography. Over the internal system, I called my colleague at the Hebrew section, Kol Israel Mirushalayim, and told her that maybe she should publish something in order to inform the Israeli Jewish citizen about the death of one of the greatest of Arab Jewish poets. Anwar who? Anwar ma? I heard it screaming. I explained briefly. Ze lo me'anyen et ha'mazinim shelanu. I think that's the first time that the Hebrew is heard here. No?
No, I don't think so.
It doesn't.
It's a long tradition of this.
It doesn't interest our listeners, she said. 2 years later, another Jewish poet died, Murad Mikhail, and in total anonymity. And over the years, other Jewish Arab Jewish poets and writers passed away: Shalom Darwish, David Tzemach, Yaakov Balbul, Yitzhak Bar Moshe. And in 2004, one of the greatest of Arab Jewish writers, Samir Nakash, died. He passed away without having the most elementary means for honorable survival. I don't exist in this country, he meant Israel, Nakash said some years before his premature death. Not as a writer, neither as a citizen, nor human being. I don't feel that I belong anywhere, not since my roots were torn from the ground in Baghdad. End of quotation. The fact, so it seems to me that most of you never heard about the writers I just mentioned, is part of the great tragedy. A tragedy which is, in fact, the topic of my project here in IMéRA, to investigate the development of our Jewish identity and culture and their demise today, in our time. Another narrative. Almost 90 years ago, the picture had been completely different. For example, the first Congress of Arabic Music was held in Cairo, 1932. Iraq was represented by a maqam orchestra, Firqat al-Maqam al-Iraqi, which included 7 members. The recitalist was Muhammad al-Qaghanji, and the other members were the following: Yehuda Shammash, Khaduri Shamma, Yusuf Za'arur, Ezra Harun, Saleh Sumayil, and Yusuf Hogi Patau. 7 members, all of them Iraqi Arabs. I'm sure that you feel some easiness. How can you say all the members were Iraqi Arabs? We hear Jewish names. Yehuda, Ezra, Harun, Hogi. Yes, you are right. 6 of the 7 members were Jews. 6 of the 7 members were Jews. The recitalist was Arab Muslim, Muhammad al-Qabanji. Between the 30s and the 80s of the last century, a very short period in historical terms, the Arab Jewish identity became gradually something of the past. Al-Huwiyya al-Arabiyya al-Yahudiyya asbahat fi khabar kan, disappeared. But at the same time, it became good merchandise for a politically oriented polemic, such as by Albert Memmi, who in January 1974 published an article entitled "What is an Arab Jew?" It was written following a discussion organized by 4 newspapers, Le Monde, The Times, La Stampa, and Die Welt. Relying on his personal experience as a Tunisian Jew, Memmi tried to show that because Jewish history has been written by Western Jews, only the Western facet of the Jewish misfortune are known. In other words, Memmi tried to show that Jews had been persecuted also by the Muslim Arabs. On the other hand, post-Zionist Jewish academics and intellectuals have shown since the 80s that the crimes of Zionism were committed not only against Palestinians, but also against Jewish immigrants from Arab countries. Here is what the Iraqi Jewish writer Nisim Rajwan, who during the 40s wrote for the Iraqi newspaper Iraq Times, says. I quote, "It is the ruling political, cultural Zionist Israeli establishment whose leaders and cultural leading lights held from the shtetls and ghettos of Russia and Russian Poland, and who masqueraded as accomplished Westerners, who subjected the Oriental emigrants to a systematic process of acculturation and cultural cleansing. Systematic process of acculturation and cultural cleansing that caused them to abandon their culture, language, and way of life. This was how Israel managed to miss what was a singular chance to integrate into the area and accept and be accepted by its neighboring countries, instead of being looked upon as an alien creation in the heart of the area in which it was established." I've presented two angles of the topic, and now I want to present a personal one. In the middle of the 90s, I completed the book as a scholar of Arabic poetry about the Muslim Iraqi poet Abdul Wahab al-Bayati. The poet himself read some chapters and encouraged me to publish the book with an Arab publisher. He even tried to help me, but my joy was premature. Soon he told me that no Arab publisher was ready to publish the book because it was written by an Israeli Jew. Bayati passed away in 1999, and the book still dwelt on my computer. To cut a long story short, only in 2002, 7 years after I finished the book, it was published by Dar al-Saqi in Beirut, Rakatan fil Ishq, Dirasa fi Shi'ar Abdul Wahab al-Bayati. But without any reference to my Jewish-Israeli identity or my academic affiliation. Okay, no problem. I understood that without such sacrifice, the book would have never been published.
In fact, in Arabic.
In fact, I didn't mind being an Israeli at the time was not a great pride after, especially after the Second Intifada in the occupied territory. In fact, even today is not a great pride after the result of the election yesterday. But the problem, they removed also the dedication, which was as follows. Il Abi, Wuli Da'am, I approach Arab because maybe.
But then you have to translate.
Yeah, of course. Il Abi, Wuli Da'am, 1921, Fi Baghdad, Iraqiyan, Musawiyan, Tufi Am 1979, Fi Haifa, Wahu Yahinu, Ila Difaf, Dijla. To my father, born in Baghdad in 1921, Iraqi of Mosaic faith, passed away in 1979 in Haifa, still longing for the banks of the Tigris. The respected Arab-Lebanese publisher imposed censorship on my father's longing for Iraq. My last English book, just published, bears this very omitted dedication. I watched recently a YouTube by Alal Aswani about civilization and barbarism. Nadwal Uspoyal, Dr. Alal Aswani, Bain al Hamajiya wal Hadara, in which he tried to explain what is the barbaric behavior. The refusal of the Israeli editor to publish a news about the death of Anwar Shaul, as well as the refusal of the Lebanese publisher to mention my dedication to my father, both of them fall within the definition of barbarism.
Of course.
You agree?
Yeah, absolutely.
What I have tried to illustrate from different angles is the unspoken agreement between the two national movements, Zionism and Arab nationalism, each with support from an exclusive divine source to perform total cleansing of Arab Jewish culture. The struggle over a small piece of territory has not hindered from seeing eye to eye in this respect. And I very much aware of the difference between the two national movements, the one inspired by European colonialism and the other an anti-colonial venture. Now, in order to give you some detail about myself, you know, Edward Helen Kerr says that you must study the historian before you begin to study the facts. I would like to give you some details of my personal background. My parents were born in Baghdad. They were forced to immigrate to Israel. They were forced to immigrate to Israel in 1951. I was born in Israel 2 years later as a Sabra, a native-born Israeli Jew. I had been taught that Arabness and Jewishness are mutually exclusive. Trying to conform to the dominant Ashkenazi European Zionist norm as a child, I felt ashamed of the Arabness of my parents. For them, I was an agent of repression sent by the Zionist establishment after excellent training into the territory of the enemy, my family, and I completed the mission in a way that only children can do with their loving parents. For example, I forbade them to speak Arabic in public or to listen to Arabic music. And it is not only the problem of Arabness, my father was also a communist activist, like many of the Iraqi and the Egyptian Jews, in a time when to be a communist in Israel was like belonging to a terrorist organization. What I remember most about my father is that he was a lover of poetry and that he always quoted Arabic verses for my benefit. I don't remember much now, only know that he insisted on reciting them, even though I didn't want to listen. But probably because I was so dumb that he had to recite again and again, I managed to find one verse because I remembered that it had something to do with camels and water, and because I had some sense of the music, which is the melody of the camel matter. It is a verse that has been attributed to the blind medieval ascetic poet Abul Ala al-Ma'arri from the 11th century, who, by the way, influenced Dante in the human comedy. كَالْعِيْسِ فِي الْبَيْدَاهِ يَخْتُلُهَا الزَّمَةِ وَالْمَاءُ فَوْقَ ظُهُورِيَا مَحْمُولُ كَالْعِيْسِ فِي الْبَيْدَاهِ يَخْتُلُهَا الزَّمَةِ وَالْمَاءُ فَوْقَ ظُهُورِيَا مَحْمُولُ Like camels in the desert, suffering from thirst, while the water is on their back. Now I understand that my father was trying to convey to me what my father tried to convey to me regarding my negative attitude at the time towards Arabic language and culture. But he had passed away long before I showed any aesthetic preference for Arabic language and literature. In fact, only after my mother passed away did I start to ask myself certain troubling questions. What is the historical background of my father's love for Arabic poetry and of my mother's love for Arabic music? Whenever I miss my mother, I listen to a favorite song by Muhammad Khindil, Gamil Wasmar, Bitmachtar, Shalal Qalbi Bikam Nazra, Tul Sukkar Aul Akhtar, Min Sukkar Midain Marra.
Should have to brought the song with
you. I will it next week. Why is something that was completely natural only 70 or even 60 years ago to be an Arab of Jewish faith now untenable? Why were entire generation in Israel educated to understand Arab culture as an inferior one? And why did a child acquire so much hatred for the culture of his parents? Why have my own daughters, when they were young, never understood how their father could wish to listen to Arab music? After all, he is not an Arab. One day, after I had given a talk in Arabic on Israeli television, my daughter came home from school and said that her friends had told her that her father was an Arab. It was not a compliment. Only in the late 80s did I ask myself whether I could refer to the sophisticated society in which I live, in terms used by Walter Benjamin almost 8 years ago. There is no document of civilization which is not, at the same time, a document of barbarism. The hybrid identity of Arab Jewish already existed before Islam. It means that a person could be an Arab and at the same time belong to the Jewish religion many years before a person could be a Muslim at all. In the 6th century AD, Jewish communities throughout the Arabian Peninsula participated in the making of the local culture, and they had distinguished poet. The personal integrity of one poet, Samaw al Ibn Adiyah, became proverbial. Samaw refused to deliver weapons that had been entrusted to him. Consequently, he witnessed the murder of his own son by the Bedouin chieftain who led siege to his castle to carry off the weapons that had been left in his charge. Samaw al, now when you say Awfa min Samaw al, more faithful than Samaw al, if you want to praise someone, that is very, very faithful. Describing the moral superiority of his own Arab Jewish tribe, Samaw al composed a poem about the noble qualities of the Arab man. The opening verse runs as follows. إذا المرء لم يتنس من اللؤم عرضه فكل رداء يرتديه جميل. إذا المرء لم يتنس من اللؤم عرضه فكل رداء يرتديه جميل. When man's honor is not defined by baseness, then every garment he wears is attractive. In the first half of the 20th century, a secular vision emerged in Baghdad and Cairo with the slogan Ad-din lillah wal-watan lil-jamil. Religion is for God. The fatherland is for everyone. In fact, a Coptic intellectual from Asyut, Tawfiq Duz, invented this slogan, Ad-din lillah wal-watan lil-jamil. I completely reject the legend carefully fostered by the Zionist establishment that the Jews of Arab land had been in terrible danger from which brilliant press cooperation saved them, without downplaying the attacks on the Jews. Because of the conflict in the Middle East and the Palestinian Nakba, it is a fact that, for example, the Iraqi Jews refused to immigrate to Israel even when the government passed in 1950 a law allowing Jewish Jews wishing to immigrate to Israel to renounce their Iraqi citizenship. The option was available only for 1 year, and the response was not strong until bombs went off in 1951 in synagogues and other Jewish institutions in Baghdad. Who threw the bombs in Baghdad? Nobody knows for sure, but I can say that most Iraqi Jews have no doubt who did it, and who had the great benefit when more than 100,000 Iraqi Jews hastened to immigrate to Israel.
So who did it?
We know that in Egypt, the same happened.
They discovered.
Discovered them.
That it was a Zionist group.
You said it. Yeah.
The lines. He said that name Mordecai, one of the names that comes up in answer to Rao's question.
One of the names?
Groups.
No, Mordecai is like literally someone who was arrested in Iraq as a...
No, and yes, but...
It
has not been proved who did it in Iraq. And if I say it now, something can bring me to court. The Iraqi establishment, the Iraqi Zionist establishment in Israel did it with other scholars. Because there is no any proof in Israel. Who did it? In Egypt,
There was a proof and it was for
we know the name. Yeah. But in Iraq we don't know. Yeah. It was an excellent operation. The Zionists tried to convince the Arab Jews to emigrate to Israel. Sometimes perhaps tried too much, like in Iraq and in Egypt. But the Ashkenazi Zionist leaders never at any stage throughout thought of Arab culture as an integral part of the new national Jewish vision to be implanted in Palestine. They were guided by what Theodor Herzl, the founder of modern Zionism, wrote in his book, The Jewish State. I quote, we should we should form a part of a wall of defense for Europe against Asia, an outpost of civilization against barbarism. One can ironically say that he not only envisioned the state of Israel, but also the wall built in the occupied West Bank almost 20 years ago. We can say also that Herzl said about the establishment of Zionism, that what he said about the establishment of a Zionist outpost of civilization against barbarism is in itself a barbaric saying. I accuse both the Muslim Arab and the Jewish Zionist national movement for including, for excluding the hybrid Arab-Jewish identity and highlighting instead the so-called pure Jewish Zionist identity against the pure Arab-Muslim one. Arab-Jewish culture has become a disease that is to be contained. The few still infected people are to be quarantined, like here in IMéRA, for fear of further contamination. I will elaborate more in my presentation next week.
March 12th.
March 12th, yes. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. If you have any questions, okay, short question. Oh, we will wait until March 12th.
Yeah.
Since when has there been this awakening from Iraqi Jews or Jews from Arab countries have awakened and started to speak out against Zionism and what Zionism has done to them? I'm familiar with the work of
only after the camp to Israel. You know, in Iraq, we don't find any Zionist, any significant Zionist activity. There were only few people. For example, I investigated, I read many collection of poets and stories of Iraqi Jews written in Iraq. No one of them speak of Zionism, nothing about Zionism. Only after they came to Israel, they started to be Zionist. That's the problem because of the education system. You know, Arabic is the language of the enemy in Israel. And we were taught to hate the Arabs. That's the problem. That's the problem.
But conversely, then after they arrived in Israel, when did they start speaking out against the bad treatment they received in Israel?
In Israel, only beginning in the 90s. In the 80s, when the new generation, like my generation, who we were born in the 50s, when we started to investigate our past, and suddenly we found that all the legend, or all the stories that told us about this rescue operation from the Arab countries, this was something of this was not the real history of the Arab Jews.
I know the work, some of the work by Ella
Shohat. Oh, well, I know it, yeah. She was one of the first. She was one of the first in the 80s that started to write about this topic. But you know, the problem that she, that's ironical, she wrote about the crime of Zionism, but she herself doesn't know Arabic.
She doesn't
know Arabic. She cannot read Arabic. You know, that's some ironical fact. Even she, who wrote about the crime of Zionism, doesn't bother to study Arabic. So the success of Zionism, you know, Zionism is a great success. Maybe the greatest success of the 20th century. I know. You know, I cannot give such lecture in America. They will kill me.
I know. Next, well, you will give many more details.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for getting to the lunch place. Maybe Marco, who's the oldest resident here, could say few words on his research with the others.
About my research.
Yeah. frighten people about cancer.
This is scary.
But it's more scary than coronavirus, so it's good to
that's
good
right.
Play.
Yeah. So that's okay. Right. Well, I guess thank you for giving me this opportunity. I guess this is totally impromptu because I just learned like seconds ago that I was supposed to do this. So I'll tell you how much time do I have?
Oh, 5 minutes. That's
5 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm a chemist. I'm not scared. Stay quiet. And I am a professor of chemistry at the University of British Columbia, Vancouver, BC, Canada. And the main focus of my research is chemical synthesis. So I deal with methods to build molecules from simple building blocks. Now, that kind of research is fundamental in the area of drug research. So everything that we take as drugs, from aspirin to the most complex molecules, have to be made by chemical synthesis. So what I do impacts directly and very forcefully drug research. I am here at the IMéRA for 10 months. I arrived in September, and I'm going to be here until July. And because I have a collaboration going on with colleagues at the Center for Cancer Research in Marseille and the Institute Polyomet, which is a huge cancer hospital here in Marseille. And we are working on a very interesting project that started with an observation they made. One of the drugs that I created and is now actually on the market for certain applications has a curious side effect.
Yep.
That is extremely valuable, right, in cancer treatments. Now, the drug that they created is a molecule, it's a small molecule. We can reasonably anticipate that by modifying this molecule, we can enhance this unanticipated side effect. And with the appropriately modified molecule, we can create a new treatment for cancer, something never before seen. So what I am doing in collaboration with my colleagues is to imagine how one can modify the molecule to make it more powerful, to make it better. They are biologists, medical doctors, and all that, so that will be biological component of the work. I focus on the chemical component. So our laboratories are the Faculty of Pharmacy. So I'm lucky that they are partly here, partly at the Faculty of Pharmacy, partly at the Cancer Research Institute. I love it.
And you'll have a big event here in IMéRA. I don't know which day. I forgot.
That's right. So it's going to be the 6th of May in collaboration with my friends at the Cancer Research Institute. We are organizing a colloquium here, one-day colloquium on drug discovery, the panorama in Marseille. Now, Marseille, for whatever reason, it's actually a very, very active center of medical and biological research. There is a lot of interesting stuff going on in Marseille, a lot of very good research in medicine, in chemistry, in the Faculty of Pharmacy. And so we thought of doing this colloquium to see what kind of opportunities exist to do something even better. And I am personally now involved in the creation of a platform at the Faculty of Pharmacy. To serve the needs of the local research community.
Yeah, that's much broader than cancer. So startup stuff.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So this will be a center to make molecules that doctors, molecular biologists, cancer researchers, and medical researchers in general may need to address serious problems in human health. Mm-hmm. So exciting stuff happening.
And this kind of platforms exist in North America, but not here, which is curious because it's an active place in this.
Absolutely right. So, as a matter of fact, we created, when I say we, I and a colleague in Vancouver, created something like that, sort of the operational, which is actually an interest site. Here in Marseille, there is no such a thing, or there is something that is too small to be really useful. In contrast, for instance, what's happening in Paris, there is everything. There is no reason why we shouldn't have the same thing here in Marseille, given the very exciting research, cutting edge research going on at the Cancer Institute and elsewhere. So this is to be a very fertile ground to do something.
Just a last question. The conference with the faculty, Is accessible? I mean, is it not too specialized to
external? It's specialized. Very, very specialized.
So we should not come.
No, quite the contrary. Quite the contrary. I mean, look, I am not an expert in history. I'm not an expert in religious matters. I'm not an expert in philosophy. I'm not an expert in anything. I happen to know a little bit about chemistry, that's it. But I just love to listen to the colleagues.
It depends on the type of talk, of course. You understand?
And, hearing humanity to provoke him on truth and stuff. So, yeah, no, you're welcome to come. And the only thing is it's going to be very technical. Because, again, we hope to attract enough attention, especially in the startup ecosystem here, to see what we can do in Marseille for them and for future startups. If this platform becomes functional within reasonable time, I think this is going to be a major catalyst.
That's a very nice collaborative stuff. Because typically what happens is that the top researchers create their own startup and they forget about everybody else.
Yeah.
And basically what you are doing is just close the gap and then allow much younger
that
people.
Absolutely right.
Which is important
and,
you could say it like this. The reality.
Yeah, I guess we also created other startups, but now I think this is the right time and the right place to do something about, something to catalyze the development of the local economy, drug research efforts, and so on.
Thank you very much, Michael.